got them apple bottom jeans, jeans, boots with the fur, with the fur. The whole club was looking at her, ay. She hit the floor, next thing you know, shawty got low, 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 low. She got low, low, low. That was his favorite song. He used to call me his shawty, and he was my flow rider. And we would get low, 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 low in the back of his car every morning before first period sex ed class freshman year. He was my tutor for that class when, like, I didn't know what went where in order to, like, make babies. He was a good fucking tutor. He never loved me. He wanted me to be the perfect Catholic goody two-shoe schoolgirl in his perfect little world. Having to go to all his stupid swim meets just to see his skinny ass lose. I mean, come on. And then having to have dinner with his rich ass Cuban family every Saturday night in their ridiculously big, okay, the mansion wasn't that bad. And they're Cuban, so those noche buenas were like a lot of fun. But then having to go to church every Sunday just so they can think I'm perfect wifey material, a woman of Jesucristo when we do get married. I mean, come on. 3 miserable years of my life pretending to be the perfect girlfriend. And that's not the best part, no. The best part is him taking all of this for granted and cheating on me with Carlita the hoe from the senior class, who will probably end up working on that strip club on 8th Street behind La Careta, boobilicious, once she graduates. At least I think that's what it's called. Ugh. Fuck. I wasn't even the proper height to be his girlfriend, apparently. Yeah, he would make me wear these stupid heels just so, like, he wouldn't, like, get scoliosis by looking down so much. And then sometimes he wouldn't even notice I was there and yell out, "Oye, mami, ¿dónde está?" And I'd be like, "I'm right in front of you, dude. Just look down." And then sometimes he had the audacity, sorry, that's not the word, the audacity to tell me, "Oye, mami, if you were like a little bit taller, maybe you would be like a little bit prettier."
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, oh yeah.
Well, you know what I say to that? Then go find yourself a king size Snickers bar, asshole. Fun size is where it's at. And so he did. Fuck. He was supposed to ask me to winter formal tonight. But then when he broke up with me today, he decided to take Carlita instead. She's 5'7" and is a size double D. I mean, how the hell am I supposed to compete with that? Now I'm the one who doesn't have a date. Cheers to that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Ugh. And the one who has to retake her SAT exam in the morning because I failed to answer that ridiculous essay question the first time around. Should people value new things, ideas, or values over old ones? What a dumb essay prompt. Should people value? Well, he never valued me. I was always everything a good girl should be. I'm the one who gets the good grades and has the perfect life and the perfect boyfriend too, apparently. Ay, mira Rosita que estudia y el novio, ay, que lindo. I don't give a fuck. Ugh. I'm unlovable. This tequila bottle's more loved than I am. Am I even pretty enough to be loved? Or tall enough? Shawty got them apple bottom jeans, jeans, boots with the fur, with the fur. The whole club was looking at her. Mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the shortest of them all? Whoa! Mommy, have you seen yourself? I don't even think you're past 5'1". Ooh, what the fuck? Who the hell are you? Mommy, I'm basically like the J-Lo version of you. You're like a Lindsay Lohan and I'm Jennifer Lopez. Think of it as a before and after picture, and I'm the end result. You can call me Bertica. Why are you even here, Bertica? Mommy, to show you what you can be, what you're missing out on. Life is too short to be living it like an unconfident coward like you, okay? How drunk am I? Not drunk enough, Mommy. Stop drinking that as if it was agüita and chug it like a drunk Latina mother on Christmas Eve. I should actually stop drinking. Fine, party pooper. Then give it to me. Hey, that's mine. Don't be a stupida. Tequila's meant to be shared, okay? Tequila. Don't take my tequila. Fine, then chug it like an alcoholic who's just escaped rehab. Oh, coño. That actually burns. No, I don't have time for this, okay? I have to study for this stupid exam. If not, I'll be forced to go to community college, and I cannot go to community college. My mom says all the drug dealers go there.
Babe, don't you think it's a little too late for that?
Plus, who cares about some stupid exam? Let's go to the club and meet some guys instead. Let's make him jealous. I mean, look at what he's missing out on. Well, he's not missing out on much, apparently.
Ay, pero mommy, don't be so pathetic, okay?
You're Rose. Rosita, you got the Latin flair and are the sexiest 5-foot Latina on the block. Okay, first of all, I am the only 5-foot Latina on the block. And second of all, am I even considered Latina? I mean, I don't really speak a lot of Spanish, and
you don't speak Spanish and you go to private school? Might as well be labeled white and privileged.
Mira, mommy, isn't the winter formal after party like tonight? We look hot, and I think we should go and show that little dickhead that beautiful piece of ass you have. Let's find you a date in the club, mommy. Empieza la música, hit it.
Let me talk to ya.
Come on.
Shawty got them apple bottom jeans, jean boots with the fur, with the fur.
But I've never gone out clubbing before.
She hit the floor, hit the floor.
My dog don't kill my vibe, don't think I'm getting low, 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 low. Plus, no other guy has even asked me out on a date.
Okay,
you know what? Yeah, stop the music. Stop. I'm bored. Okay, you know what, mommy? They're not going to the club for that. But maybe if you put some extra padding under your bra, something might happen. I mean, the shit works wonders, Mina. I'm just saying. Bertica, I actually miss him. Okay? Oh my God, mommy, you need to wake up. Do you want to die as a false image pleasing everybody else? Well, I mean, when you put it that way. No, exactamente. You should listen to me more often, you know, because I'm you. What was I even thinking?
Mommy, you were in. All the blood rushed out of that brain and went to those fake facial expressions.
Careful. If you don't stop now, I mean, you'll get wrinkles. My entire life has been one big stupid lie because of me.
Ay, there, there, don't be so dramatica.
My friends never liked me.
I mean, yeah, you don't have a lot of them.
My parents don't even understand me.
I mean, again, mommy, do I have to repeat myself? You're pretty unlikable.
And the guy I thought loved and respected me the most cheated on me.
god, mommy, you should look at yourself in the mirror.
Have you seen Carlita's boobs, though?
Oh my god, I'm pretty sure she got them done. I'm just saying.
That's it!
Ooh, woo! That's what I'm talking about. Tequila.
How am I supposed to study for my stupid SAT exam tomorrow like this?
Mira, mommy, I'll make you a deal, okay?
If you call him and stand up to him tonight, I'll help you answer the question for the stupid DLZ exam, okay, mommy? Pertica, it's pronounced S-A-T.
Yeah, DLZ, S-A-T, same shit, different toilet. What was the question? Go.
Okay. Should people value new things, ideas, or values over old ones? Should people value new things, ideas,
or values over old ones? ¿Qué eso, mami? Oh my god. I don't know. Ask Jesucristo. He knows everything.
Pertica! Well, I think you should value a new hookup or boyfriend over your old trashy one, mommy. I think maybe you're right. I think I am going to call him.
Finally, things are getting a little bit interesting.
Ooh, while you're at it, ask him where Carlita got her boob job. Okay. Yeah. Ask him where Carlita got her boob job.
Went to voicemail.
Oye, mami. Huh? Es tu papi chulo. Look, I'm not at the phone right now, but DM me on my Insta if you want some. Okay. You know what I'm saying? Besito para ti. Coño, me tiene más pelado que la mata en mango. Oh. Mami, si yo fuera un mosquito, ¿dónde quieres que te muerda?
Hey, my papi chulo mosquito flow. Right? Sorry, force of habit. Mira, Rosita, don't play nice. You were raised in a Latin household. Now take the belt out and show him who's boss. Okay, yeah. Oye, you dirty man whore. It's me, your favorite drunk ex-novia. I'm not drunk, but yeah. You're probably too busy
grinding to some shitty Usher song at the winter formal after party.
But I'm here to tell you that. Well, I'm here to tell you that. Well, what am I here to tell him again? Ay, pero mami, you don't need him anymore, Rosita. Yeah, I don't need you anymore, Rosita. I've had a long, great talk with my two best friends, Bertica and Tequila Patron, and they both think that I deserve way better than you, right, Bertica?
Mira, we're her only friends. This is why she's single.
Oh, yeah, and hey, and have fun not having a piece of this ass, which, by the way, grew 2 inches since last summer. It was all those tamales my mom made. Now finish him off, Rosita. Finish him. Oh, yeah. Yeah. And thanks to you, buddy, these doors right here have been closed. But guess what? There's about to be a grand opening, and you're not invited. Also, where did Carlita get her boobs done?
The mailbox is full and cannot accept any messages at this time.
Fuck.
Goodbye.
God damn it! Damn it! Ugh. Fine. He wants to be like that? Hmm? Drunk texting it is.
Mommy, I'd be careful if I were you. Don't send something you might later regret.
Oh, now you have a conscience, Pertica. Well, you know what? I'm gonna text him in all caps that he is a lying hippopotamus. Sorry, autocorrect, delete. He is a lying hypocrite. And él es un fuckboy que no puede fuck properly. And,
wait for it, hold on.
His dick isn't even that big.
See? Mommy, I don't know about that last one. You'd be lying to yourself. I mean, it's pretty big. I'm just saying.
Sent! No, carajo! I sent it to my mom! Fuck! What was I thinking? I have to study for this stupid exam!
Time goes by faster when you're drunk. Have you never done this before?
No! What am I supposed to do now, Pertica?
I mean, well, don't give up now, Rosita,
but if you do fail this exam, we can just work at Boobilicious instead.
Think about it. We could get discounts. Who cares about medical school? It's so hard. What am I supposed to do now? I'm gonna fail. Stop it. Do not hit yourself. Okay, you know what? Bertica, this is where you have to come in and be the motivational speaker you were meant to be. Come close and repeat after me. Come on. Your name is Rosita. My name is Rosita. And you are the sexiest 5-foot Latina on the block. And I am the sexiest 5-foot Latina on the block. Your ass is the best ass. Yeah, I have a pretty good ass. But most importantly, Rosita, you are strong, confident, and beautiful. Just the way you are, mommy. I'm strong, confident, and beautiful. Just the way I am. My name is Rosita. I am woman. Hear me roar. My God, you fuck. Oh, yeah. Oh, mi cabeza. Finally. The last question. Should people value new things, ideas, or values over old ones? I mean, que eso? Well, in my opinion, I don't think people ever stop valuing old ideas. And new things, values, and ideas are never really left behind. They just become developed and improved, stemming from the growth of the person. Like me, developing into Bertica. Now that's total bullshit. The only thing that people should value in life is... Tequila Patron, baby! Mm. Oh. Now that should get me into Harvard. Shit.
Fuck! No! Okay. What did I do? It's okay. I got this. I got this. Lo puedes hacer. Despierta, hijo de puta! Come on, wake up! Fuck! Oh, it's okay. Respira. Breathe. Everything is going to be fine. Remember what this is for, what this is about. Okay, ahora para atrás, para la cabeza, para que abran los huecos. Come on, despierta, wake up, we don't have much time. Sí. Hello? Are you good? You're awake? Yes! Oh, I thought I lost you there for a second. Oh, oh, don't mind the things, but... Oh, perdón, que rudo mi. Buenos días. ¿Cómo estás? How are you doing? Oh. Do you know? You have a really beautiful place. Better than mine, at least. A little bit more organized. Ooh, a nicer kitchen. And the bathroom with running water. Oh, do you know? It's funny. You go through life trying to be the best version of yourself that you can be. Especially aquí, where your family wants you to grow above and beyond, not just the familial issues, but from this country's issues as well. They want what's best for you because they're going to get afraid that you're going to make the wrong choice and then suffer the consequences for it. Even though sometimes you didn't really choose it, but they just want what's best for you, right? Family always wants what's best for you. Even with all the arguments and disagreements, they would never want to see you doing bad. Even when you make a choice that they don't agree with, they will always love you and support you no matter what you do or choose. At least a good family with good people. Mi familia were good people. I'm guessing yours was too, right? Was your family good people? Were they? Ah! So they were! Oh, so está bien. That's good. Where do they live? Any chance? Actually, wait, I can answer that. Let me guess. They are refugees in another country, or they're living here, just very, very far, far away from you. Now tell me, Juan, or should I say Rodrigo? Oh, you definitely haven't heard that in a long time. Maybe your mother was the last time, or a significant other. Actually, you know what? I don't care. But now, Rodrigo, answer me this. Why did mi familia have to die? And I don't mean by natural causes or one-off events, but by just being collateral damage. They were just collateral damage at the end of the day, no? Another political statement from La FARC or LN or any other shitty guerrilla group, right? Now, this is not going to be hard for you, Rodrigo, but imagínate killing soldiers with families, kidnapping women and children, planting explosives and taking lives as if they had no worth. And what for? What for? Over 260,000 innocent people have died. People who didn't do anything. People who were just living their lives. Spending time with their families. Eating pan de bonos and pastries on a Sunday morning. Taking out their little sister out for ice cream on a Wednesday afternoon after she had a rough day at school. This is what was taken away. What you took away. Oh, and what about those who survived? Thank you for asking. Muchas gracias. Thank you. 8 million of nuestra gente have ran from this beautiful country because of the pain and damage you have caused to their families and este país. And those who stayed, they had to live with their own misery and grief and continue on with their lives with little empathy. Being told, así es la vida. Así es la vida. That's life, right? And do you want to know what the cherry on top of all of this is? After all the lives that you have taken and people you've made to suffer, do you get to live like this? No jail time, no death sentence. Después de todo eso, you get a job in less than 24 hours, no questions asked. And on top of the salary of your job, the government pays you monthly because you're part of rehabilitation. Rehabilitation. Qué chistoso. How funny. You and many other guerrilla friends of yours have gotten a second chance. The people who ran, they struggled, but they made their second chance. And what about the people like me? Huh? Do you know? Those who stayed. Did we get a second chance? Huh? Did you kill, kidnap, manipulate? Did you kill, kidnap, manipulate? You do this over and over and over and over again, and you get a second chance? Yo! Did my family get a second chance, ah, hijo de puta? Saturday, May 26, 2001. Around 8 in the morning in our beautiful city of Bogota, Colombia, a bomb went off in the National University. 20 people were injured, and 4 died on the spot. The ones closest to the blast. My father, my mother, my older brother, and my little sister. I slept in that morning, and they had promised me to bring back home breakfast after they finished helping my brother in La Universidad with whatever I did. I don't remember. Okay, just... breakfast never came. Only 2 policías, 2 cops. But maybe there was a chance. Maybe we could still have Sunday breakfast, right? Maybe they were one of the 20 people injured. Right? Sunday breakfast never happened again. I was 11, and I had no family. None of my friends, families, or anybody wanting to take you in, a little orphan. All I did before that was go to school, comer pan de bonos, jugar football, eat, sleep, do my homework, have fun being there for my family. Kissing my abuelitos goodnight, pleasing my mother, my father, my siblings. And all of a sudden, it's like you're a freak of society for having no family. No familia. No one helps you. All you're given, you're not given a second chance. All you're given is pity. Pity. You then end up on the streets trying to make a living. I ended up distributing marijuana, even though personally I don't like it, but more people like it, other people like it. So why not take advantage, right? Supply and demand. I needed the money. And I didn't care. I didn't care if I got arrested, if the cops found me out. I did not care. What did I have to lose, huh? I had nothing to lose. Eventually, I made enough to afford my own place. Small, messy. Sometimes there's not enough water in the building, but we move. Seguimos. I can't go to La Universidad. I can't finish my studies because I can't afford it. But I recently found a job, and it pays decent, it pays well. And I stopped distributing marijuana or the medicinal or the... I don't care what they call it. I'm trying to say is... I survived. I made my second chance when the world didn't lend a helping hand once. Only until recently, with like two friends and my boss, my new boss, who gave me the job. Meanwhile, all this time, you, after everything you did, you get the help of everyone and their mother! Even though you probably killed half of their families, right? I know. Killing you won't bring my family back. But all this forgiveness you're getting, you don't deserve it. You deserve to rot in el infierno. I'm not like you. Just remember, I'm not like you. But at this point, it's not about what's right. It's about what's fair. I don't understand. I don't understand how you could live with yourself. How much humanity do you have to lose to take lives? Ah! Do you know this? This is so fucking difficult. Because your brain knows that with one pull of the trigger, you can end it all. Cuéntame. Does it get easier? Is that the reason? The more people are shot, tortured, or blown up, does your conscience rest better at night after that first night that you took a life? Huh? I could have gone on a killing spree. Do you know? I could have killed you or killed other members or tortured them, because at the end of the day, de todas maneras, they ruined the lives of other families. But the thing is, about your little terrorist group, is that they claim responsibility as a whole. So, how am I supposed to go up against an entire group? I can't! But, thanks to the peace treaty between nuestro gobierno and the guerrillas, you got the second chance. The rehabilitation program. And before we saved you and integrate you back in society, you have to confess about the crimes that you committed and which ones were your idea and which ones you executed. But it's okay. All those documents are classified. But... like anything in this country and in the world that we live in, all you need is a little bit of persuasion and a little bit of blackmail to get what you want. And now we're here, Rodrigo, tú y yo, after all these years. After all the guerrilla members you betrayed, after all these survivors, did you think it would be me? Did you think it would be me to do this to you? I know killing you won't bring my family back. I worked so hard to find out who you were and find you. Survive just so that I can come up against you. One day, un día! In 10 minutes, you have almost shed the tears that I've shed in 20. Oh. Oh. See you in hell, Rodrigo. Oh, but the look on your face. Oh, that's priceless. But still, not enough tears. Not enough. You should have seen your face. But remember, Rodrigo, I'm not like you. I'm not. But you know what I am going to do, Rodrigo. I'm going to put your destiny in your own hands. Let's just see if you have enough time. I wish you luck, Rodrigo. Maybe we'll see each other, maybe not. I don't know. It was nice getting to know you these past 15 minutes, as well as the past 20 years in my nightmares.
Well, when you're working on a project, working with some of the greatest talent in the industry, on a show that you created, one thing you learn? How to stay humble. Go for James.
Yeah, hi. This is Janice Lane.
Janice! Yes, hi. Is everything okay? Look, I know there was a few bumps in the road with the new script, but I am just so happy with the way that everything turned out. I'm popping a bottle of champagne right now.
I just got off the phone with the producers. We'd love to work with you. We really would. But they said they're gonna have to move in a different direction.
And by different direction, you mean, a whole new script. Uh-huh. Nobody likes comedy anymore. You can tell I was bullied in high school by the way I write. No, I'm still listening. Well, look, Janice, I can change a few of the jokes around if you want me to, but by tonight? I can do that. Just, let the producers know that I'm on it, okay? Okay? Hello? Cool. So just, write a whole new script by tonight, or your dreams of, paying rent this month are flushed down the drain. It's fine. I got a million scripts here. Alright, just, but not comedy. Not comedy? Okay, I think I got it. It's a wealthy upper-class boy whose parents are shot in cold blood, and he becomes a detective vigilante known as... I should have known. What, you thought they would actually pull through with their plans and write the show with you? No, nobody ever does that. Oh, dude, you're so funny. Come be a writer for us in L.A. Quit your job at the Cheesecake Factory. Come live your dreams in L.A. Fuck that. They just needed someone to sign the lease. L.A. is where dreams come to die. Maybe I'll think of something in the morning. Too kind, really. Yes, folks, welcome back to the most exhausting and exhilarating late-night talk show on television, Chip Off the Block, the only show that doesn't care whether or not our guests are trying to sleep. What's the matter, James? Cat got your tongue? God, I love when they do that. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, Chip Off the Block is what we'll be doing here tonight as we attempt to whittle down our guest writer's block to see if he can create something worth watching. James, it's always a pleasure to have you on the show. What the hell are you people doing in my house? Yes, ladies and gentlemen, tonight we will get to the truths. We will ask the hard-hitting questions. We will figure out why James is such a terrible writer. It's all very exciting, and I'm thrilled to be your host for the evening. But before we get into the show, let's do some topical political humor. Folks, what is going on in the White House today? The president, am I right? That's where you laugh. Our next big news break comes straight from the Hollywood studios, where our guest star James was denied the green light to his new script. Who knew screenwriting was hard? Not him. But us here on the show have a much bigger heart than those corporate studio bigwigs. We're not going to let him go down that easy. We'll give James a little taste of fame by hosting his very first live interview. Let's go ahead and give it up for our guest star tonight, local insomniac and failed screenplay writer, James McKellen. James! James, you're on the show tonight because you can't write a decent script to save your life, or your lease. And we're going to attempt to figure out why that is. James, it's always a pleasure. You're just a stupid character that I wrote. You're not real. I can't believe this. Well, you better start believing it, kid. Seriously, start believing it. I don't have a lot of time on this show, and I'm not wasting a second explaining to a writer why exposition is boring. James, I'm hungry. I'm hungry for you. If I could crack your head open like an egg and scoop your brains out with a spoon, I would, but James, it's just not that kind of show. You wanted to be famous, walk amongst the stars, well, now's your chance. We have a way of getting you warmed up to these questions, James. Questions about why you do the things in your life that you do. We will analyze, capitalize, and scrutinize every part of your life in a brand new segment we like to call Where Did I Go Wrong? Yes, oh, thank you. Yes, the audience will have an opportunity to dive deep into that big ball of caffeinated mush you call a brain. James, are you ready?
I don't know if I'm ready right now. It just, it all went so much differently in my head.
Good thing I don't care. Let's go ahead and get the show on the road, folks. Who's got a question for James? Go ahead and raise your hand. Who's got a question? Who's got a question? Yes, yes, you! Hold on a second, Missy. Let me get over right to you. Where are you from?
I am from West Palm Beach.
You're from West Palm Beach. That's fantastic. And you came all the way out here to see James, is that correct?
All the way out here, yes.
To see James, not me.
Of course, to see James.
Wow. I am offended. But I won't hold that against you. If you got a question for James, go ahead and shoot your shot now.
So, my question is, why do all of your stories end up being comedies?
Oh, that's gotta hurt. James, why do all of your stories end up being comedies?
Well, I always knew I was, different. I wasn't like the other boys at school. I tried to hide it, keep it a secret. But I knew it would come out. It's just a matter of time. My mother always knew. I mean, she had to if it was so obvious. I remember watching Johnny Carson's as a kid, and I felt something bubbling inside of me. It was a laugh. That's when I knew. That's when I knew I was different. I was, well, I am hilarious. My father never approved of my lifestyle choice. He said I'd never get anywhere in life, but you know what? I don't care, Dad! I'll never work a 9-to-5 like you! Wow. I can't tell if you're being serious or not. James, we don't want the questions. We don't want the... James, we don't want the jokes. It's not about that. We want you, the real you. Let's try this. You said that society doesn't accept you. Why do you think that is? Well, I was being serious about that. Well, of course they don't accept me. Studios like this have been pumping out family-friendly fart jokes for the past 10 years. So of course, when they see a script like mine, a decently crafted, well-written script, they don't know what to do with it. I mean, is it my fault? I mean, I guess so, because nobody wants my goddamn scripts. Wow. The motivation we're seeing here tonight is inspiring. Oh, what an artist. James, the first time I read your script, I thought it was pretentious, derivative, painfully unfunny. After you said that right now, us in the studio went back and reread your script, and James, I gotta tell you, my opinion has not changed whatsoever. You can't explain your way out of bad writing, James. It's just not possible. You keep answering like this, and you'll be moving back in with your parents in no time. Let's see if the audience can help us one more time. Who's got a question? Raise your hand. Raise your hand. Yes, yes, you.
Why do you feel the need to impress everyone around you?
Oh, that one's gotta hurt. James, why do you feel the need to impress everyone around you? What the fuck kind of question is that? I could ask the same thing to you. What, you think you're special because he gave you a little note card and you got to say it, huh? Well, what's the matter? Did I get the question right? You know what? It's because I'm an asshole. Is that what you want to hear? I'm an egotistical asshole, and all I ever want to do is hear myself talk. James, don't you see? Your whole life you've been putting yourself down in a vain attempt to pull yourself back up, talking to yourself like one of those nobodies. And what about me? James, I'm your biggest fan. All I've been doing tonight is helping you figure out why you do the things in your life that you do. Look at how far you've gotten. Look at how far we've come. You were tired, and you failed. So what? But James, it's not about how hard we fall. It's about how we pull ourselves back up. And the question we're all waiting for you to answer is, are you gonna pull yourself back up? What's happening? What's going on? You know what, I'm tired of playing these games. If you got a question for me, just say it. Say it!
What are you going to write?
I don't know, okay? I don't know! I wish I could write some deep, powerful drama about family and love and loss, but I don't know where to start. I want to be honest and vulnerable with my scripts, but there is this anxious-ridden, green, toxic ball that wants to jump out of my throat and make everyone think that I am good and that I'm special, and I don't know where it came from. I don't know if it'll always be there, but it's here right now. And I don't think it's going away anytime soon. So I am constantly looking for an indication, a gauge marker, a milestone in their looks at me or their tone of voice to see if they like me. Because I don't. In the best way, the fucking best way to tell if someone likes you is a joke. You make them like you. It's the way I do it. It doesn't matter if it's real or not. You just got them to show you that they at least care enough not to be rude. It's greedy. It's selfish. Honestly, it's fucking manipulative. But I have to. I have to, because they're not going to care about me if I don't. If I do it the right way, and I show them who I am, they're gonna find out the truth. That I'm empty inside. I'm boring. The second they see that, they're not gonna care about me. I mean, sure, maybe in a human way, but you can't sell boring. So I learned how to make them laugh by writing these shitty television sitcoms, because when they laugh at my jokes, it means that I matter. That people think I matter. I don't want to be insignificant. It hurts too much to be insignificant. It means I shouldn't have been here to begin with.
James, I didn't expect this out of you. It's raw, it's honest. It's everything our studio is looking for. I think a lot of people will relate to this story, James. An innocent classic. Tell me, how did you come up with this?
I had some help.
What a fucking mess.
You have received the Cash App payment of $5,000.
Thank you. Alexa, play my cleanup playlist.
They say that I'm a witch. And that I weave a spell. Well, I'll use my eyes to invite you, my lips to delight you, and all the charms of the feminine wiles to excite you. They say that I'm a witch and that I weave a spell. Well, I'll be a son of a and a wonder. Well, let me tell you, brother, I'd rather be burned as a witch. Burned it all. I use my songs to entice you with verses of ice you, and all of my bags of tricks to shoes and rice you. They say that I'm a witch and that I weave a spell. Well, I'll be a son of a and a wonder. Well, let me tell you, brother.
Alexa, tomorrow's to-do list, please.
Never be burned it all. Tomorrow, Saturday, January 8th, 2022, 11 a.m. Brunch with Michelle, 3 p.m. Manny Petty at Lucky Nail, 5 p.m. Boxing and mixed martial arts class.
Okay, no. Switch the Manny Petty to 5 and the boxing mixed martial arts to 3. I do not want to chip a nail and have to go back. No, thank you.
Schedule edited successfully.
Okay, continue, please.
9 p.m. Track down next kill.
Target name?
Target name, Chad Daniels.
Location?
Location, ENA Bar and Lounge, 1 a.m. New Year's cleaning.
All right, well, we got a busy day ahead of us, so let's get in some self-care time so I'm on my A game for Chad tomorrow. Alexa, play my Baddies Who Meditate playlist.
I am a queen.
I am a queen.
I am a part of God.
I am a part of God. I am a living God.
I am a powerful.
I am a motherfucker!
Goddess.
I am strong. I am patient. I am going to keep my eyes on you. God, this isn't working. Okay, Alexa, stop. Okay, you know what? Fuck the meditation. I know I am strong, I am powerful, and I am whatever else it takes to be a woman who kills. Thank you, Alexa. That's all I needed to hear. Okay, you know what? I just really need a comfort movie right now, and we're not gonna do horror because I made that mistake last night after that creepy kill I did. Jeffrey something. I wish it was Bezos, but this guy was so much creepier. Anyway, I had some gnarly nightmares. Let's do something I don't have to put too much thought into. How about The Notebook? That's a classic. Alexa, play The Notebook on Netflix.
Hey, what are you doing?
Hey, you can't do that!
I'll tell you when I get down, Tommy. I'm no Calhoun. So it's really nice to meet you. Who is this guy?
I don't know. No Calhoun.
I would really like to take you out.
Friend, do you mind?
This movie sucks! God, such a sucky, fucking suckish movie!
Okay, Tommy, all right.
The movie that sucks! Alexa, pause! Okay. Men don't do that. Men don't act like that. Maybe at the time the movie was set, like the 40s or some shit. No! No! History doesn't work that way. We don't get to the 40s and all of a sudden men know how to act. In the movie, and in history, I'm pretty sure, men were coming back from World War whatever, and it was one wrong move for us gals, and boom! Don't you ever burn my casserole again, Peggy, so I fought for our country! This romantic bullshit only occurs in movies. You see, he even has me questioning this shit. Mr. Sparks. No. Nicholas, you are a sick little man. Wrapping these movies in a pretty Ryan Gosling kissing in the rain scene bow and marketing it as a romance movie when we both know this is nothing short of a fairy tale for adult women. Now I'm remembering why I turned to horror last night. Because at least with horror, they give you the real shit. Serial killers and ghosts. The real sadistic movie makers are the ones like Nicholas Sparks. Yeah, and if you were alive, you'd probably suggest we watch American Psycho, since men have such a throbbing boner for a handsome, power-hungry socialite who lives out his glorious prostitute-slaughtering dreams. Yes, super heterosexual indeed. Oh, and by the way, Patrick Bateman would 100% kill you too. Take it from a serial killer herself. And you didn't die because you can live up to the unattainable standards the media creates for us. No. You died at the hands of a crazed female serial killer because your women were so perturbed by your existence because they thought they might lose theirs. Or because the damage had already been done, and you deserve to suffer the same. So what do? They call me. And just a piece of their hearts is at rest. Yep, I'm the real American Psycho! You want women to be crazy so bad? Well, here I am, batshit crazy! Oh, but it's not so hot when a woman doesn't, huh? Right, because in my version, you act like that asshole in the movie, you die. You abuse a woman, you die. You rape a woman, you die. You rape me, you die. Now, if you want to make my job easier and take each other out, then that's just what I like to call natural selection. You see, the only real solution here is
radical misandry, not feminism. Feminism doesn't work. You said so yourself, and I agree. No one will ever be equal because you know women are superior. And if you see women are beginning to catch on to that, even just for a second, your whole world quite literally crumbles. You are so self-aware of your own inferiority that everything you do is rooted in it. Oh, and then us women applaud the bare minimum because we think you are simply incapable of doing better. But you are. And so the cycle continues. But you want us to stop complaining. We already have so much. Fine. You want me to stop complaining? There. I stopped. Well, maybe not, but I certainly took matters into my own hands. I was so lost before. I didn't know what to do with all this potential, but not anymore. Because I finally found a healthy work environment where I am the CEO and HR. Because I finally understand that it's my life's purpose to terrorize and terminate men like you. Because it seems that that's what your life's purpose is too. And I am simply not above spending the rest of my miserable time on Earth as a woman eradicating your kind and being an absolute menace back. You guys hate when we say kill all men, but if you and your friends wouldn't literally kill all women, we wouldn't have to say that. It's the only logical option, anyway. Anyway, where were we with this piece of crap? I hate not finishing shit. Alexa, play. Oh, and another thing. Alexa, pause. I love when you guys use the whole daddy issues card on me. Oh, I love it. I just do. Because I cannot even begin to count how many times a man has told me that I act like a raging bitch because my father never loved me, or because he cheated on my mom, or because, like you said, I simply didn't have one. And then I get to have the absolute pleasure of telling them, just like I told you, you dirty sewer rat, that my dad is my best fucking friend. And his name is Frank Clement. He lives in the Bronx, New York. Don't believe me? Look him the fuck up. Like, the audacity to think that my dad would be the one to ruin men for me. No, hun. Men ruined men for me. And anyway, you couldn't be half the man he is if you tried. That's a man I believe would do all this Nicholas Spark shit. My dad is a saint. If I ever saw one. He set the bar high with the way he treated my mom and made it a point for me to never accept anything less. They just don't make men like him anymore. It was other men who took that same bar down like a gazillion notches, and I had to adjust. My dad treats me like a princess, so it really isn't my fault that my response to men not meeting my standards is off with their heads. He actually taught me a lot of what I know. I mean, the seducing and the playing the whole damsel in distress role is all my natural talent, but the whole street smarts, kicking assery, and marksmanship, that's all him. You see, he knew men like you would come around and call me fatherless, among other atrocities, and I would need to defend myself. Unlike other dads, who let girls find out the hard way. I just don't think he ever thought I'd be using his skills so literally, or as a career. But if you think about it, he is the real reason you are here today. God, I really wish you were alive. You really need to hear some of this. Not that you would have done anything about it anyway, because with you was in one ear and out the other. Alexa, play.
Out.
Well, will you go out with me?
What? No!
No?
No!
No.
Hey, Pat.
You see, this is exactly what I'm talking about. Alexa, pause. You were just like him. And he is the Prince Charming of this suckfest. But I'll give it to him. This is the one and only real scene from this shit. And it's that you guys are apparently allowed to ignore the concept of no means no. No, in your mind, means convince me. And women are so afraid of saying no because you are so unaccustomed to hearing it that when you do, you throw a bitch fit. Like the asshole in this suckfest, threatening his life just to get this girl to say yes. That's why I live by a very easy motto. You ignore a no from a woman, I ignore your no when you're pleading for your life. I mean, you were so annoying when you were about to die. It was like you finally understood the concept. How convenient. Well, you just shouldn't have been wearing such a suggestive asshole suit. I mean, you were practically asking for it. And you probably shouldn't have drank so much. If you had some respect for yourself, like my father does, you wouldn't have found yourself in this situation. And since we're on the topic of dads, you know that phrase, it takes one to know one? Well, if I'm not one, that is a fatherless bitch, like you called me, then you're just projecting. And if you had a dad that loves you like mine does, you wouldn't be sitting in this chair fatherless and lifeless. God, I wish I had killed you before I got to hear all of your nonsensical bullshit ideologies. And I promised my therapist I wouldn't let dead men bother me anymore. Well, those weren't her exact words. She said insignificant men, but I think we both understood what each other was trying to put down. One, two, three, four. Dead men don't bother me anymore. One, two, three, four. Dead men don't bother me anymore. Okay. I've made my peace with it. Alexa, play.
Get down, no, you're gonna kill yourself!
No, cut it out!
Well, will you go out with me?
What? No!
No?
No!
No.
Hey, pal, she just told you.
Why not?
I don't know, because I don't want to.
Noah! All right, well, you leave me no other choice then.
Oh, oh my God!
I'm the king! No, stop fooling
around! Ah! Fuck! Oh. It's way past my office hours! God! What do you want?
Call from no caller ID.
Ugh. Hi, you've reached Lola's Cupcake Service. I am unable to come to the phone right now. I'm probably busy baking in my kitchen where a woman belongs. Please do not leave a message at the beep.
Girl, really? You can't just trauma dump onto me in the middle of the night. I have boundaries too. Alexa, end voicemail message. Whoever it is can call back tomorrow. I'm not a therapist. God, what time is it? I need to go. Well, this was fun, but you need to leave, so. Oh my God, what do you want?
Call from no caller ID.
God, you're fucking persistent. I hate when people can't respect a boundary. I don't have many rules, and you're not entitled.
I'm sorry. Please, just hear me out. I just need to tell.
Alexa, answer.
The voicemail time limit has run out.
It's fine. If it's something serious, she'll call back again.
Call from no caller ID.
Alexa, answer.
Hello? Hello?
Yes, hello. Are you okay?
Yes. I mean, no. Well, I'm not in any immediate danger. I didn't mean to scare you.
All right, honey, what do you need? Because it's late and I'm trying to go, so.
Sorry, I know I'm not supposed to do this, but I need your help. I sent you a letter some time ago, but that takes too long and I didn't know what else to do. The name of the man I need help with is Frank.
Okay, can I get a last name?
Clement. Frank Clement.
Frank Clement? That's a specific name. Okay, do you know where this Frank Clement lives?
610 Waring Ave, the Bronx.
What? No, honey, I think you have the wrong address. Listen, it's late, and you can just call back tomorrow when your head is clear, okay? I need to go and,
No. Please, it's the right address, I promise.
Then you mixed up the name. I don't have time for this. I need to...
Yes, it is. It's the right guy, and it's the right address. Please, if you could just...
Then I don't know what to tell you. You have the wrong information, okay? Whatever happened to you, you're probably still in shock from it, and you're not thinking right. I need accurate information. I just don't go around killing innocent people because somebody called me in the middle of the night.
But he's not innocent. He literally...
Listen! I don't know what happened, but you are seriously confused. I need you to stop spreading false information because you are going to seriously get someone hurt. That could be someone's son or their brother or their... You just need to take a deep breath and recollect yourself. You've obviously gone through something traumatic, and you're not thinking right. Your memory is foggy. Trust me, it happens. It happened to me when I was... It happened to me. If you can remember the correct man's name and address, then I can help you.
Oh, I understand. You won't do anything about it because you know him. You're not going to help me because tomorrow I'm going to call back and it's going to be the same name. I am not in shock and my memory isn't foggy, although I wish it was because this man abused me a long time ago. And yet I wish I could forget his address.
Then why? No. No. No, it's not him. It's not him. It's not him. No. Takes one to know one, huh? Look alive. You're gonna have some company soon. Alexa, play.
Sorry now. Sorry now. sad and blue.
Así es que era de este de quien estabas enamorada, maldita lisiada. ¡De mi nacido! Ves que lo dije. Que no se te ocurriera poner los ojos en él. ¡Y los pusiste! ¡Es muy clavabosa! ¡Te atreviste! ¡Pero te va a pesar! ¡Te va a pesar! Te voy a dar una paliza que no vas a olvidar en tu vida, inválida del demonio.
¡Déjala su vida! ¡No se le ocurra
pedirle! ¡Quítate, infeliz! ¡Quítate, vieja porra!
Hi, my name is
Javi.
Quiet on set!
Quiet on set! ¿Cómo que quiet on set? ¿Tú me estás mandando
a callar? No, mami, I don't mean it like that. No, I don't mean to like shut up, but just like turn the volume down a little. I'm recording the audition. It's for tomorrow. It's very important. Thank you. Ya, Javier Raúl, ya, se acabó. Se acabaron las excusas, se acabó la come mierdería, se acabó la vagancia, se acabó la mediocridad. Get it the fuck together, man. For how long did you know you had to turn in this audition, dude? No, I don't have time. There's no time, is what you always say, but that's not true. Papi, you don't have time now because you spent the lot you had high as the sun scrolling through bullshit Instagram or TikTok, Reddit. You make me sick. I know, but there's not enough hours in the day to complete what it is that they demand of us. That's why they sent you the audition requirements 2 months ago. And guess what? You're a senior now. Super senior, actually, mister. I'm gonna take a year off to work on myself. We're back! If you actually fucking worked on yourself, this wouldn't be so hard. Because you're about to be a super duper senior if you don't turn in this stupid little video of you saying your stupid little name, spitting your stupid little monologue, and doing a stupid little song and dance. Man, you don't even have to go anywhere. It's a self-tape this year because of COVID. No, but, oh, I've been in my room all year. I'm so depressed. The isolation. I can't tell the difference between a week ago and last year. It all feels like the same day. I want to go back to normal. There's no such thing as going back to normal. In the present, nothing has ever been normal at any point throughout all time. This is your life now. Shit, at least you have a room. More people than your spoiled little me mind can even begin to consider have nothing, okay? Nobody. Their whole life is on a sidewalk. Meanwhile, you are comfy at mommy and daddy's, whining and crying and shitting and farting about how hard it is to be you. Stop it. You don't understand what a blessing it is to have the biggest problem in your life be that you have to turn a self-tape in at the last minute. Look at you. You're in your room. You're not hungry, thirsty, naked. You have friends. You live with your parents, boo-hoo, but at least they're still alive. And they take care of you. Okay, they might not care about what you do or even understand it. They haven't come to a single one of your shows, but at least they don't ask for rent. So thank God. Man, 4 years. 4 years you knew this was coming. It's nothing new. There's a general audition at the beginning of every school year. You get an email with audition requirements. You find material that suits you, that says, this is who I am. You work on your material like a dog. Make yourself presentable. Turn it in. Do the thing. You're done. Did you die? If the hardest part is getting started, get on with it. Get on with it. Why? Jesus Christ. Hi, my name is Javier Raul, and my name is John Johnson, and I come from Wisconsin. That's what you sound like. That's what you sound like. It's like you don't even know how to say your own fucking name. Hi, my name is Javier Raul, and now I sound like I'm on Telemundo. Just fucking say it like yourself. Just be yourself. Hi, my name is Javier Raul, and I'll be doing a monologue from the play King Lear by Shillian Blatt. Bah, 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 bah. Whoopsie. Fuck! Okay, just stop. Now I can act. Hi, my name is Javier Raul, and I'll be doing a monologue from the play King Lear by William Shakespeare. Yes! Yes! Good! Good! Good job. Keep going. Thou, nature, what is this? What is this? What is this? What are you doing? What are you doing? Thou, nature, art my goddess. To thy law, my services are bound. Wherefore should I? Wherefore should I stand in the plague of custom? Huh? You know it. So just do it. Right? Thou, nature, art my goddess. To thy law, my services are bound. Wherefore should I stand in the plague of? Okay. All right. Thou, nature, art my goddess, to thy law my services are bound. Wherefore should I stand in the plague of custom and permit the curiosity of nations to deprive me? For that I am some 12 or 14 moonshines lack of a brother white bastard. Wherefore base, when my dimensions are as well compact, my mind is generous, and my shape is true as honest madam's issue. Why brand they us with base, with base and bastardy base, base who in the lusty self of nature take more composition and fierce quality than doth within a dull, stale, tired bed gold to the creating a whole tribe of fops? Got tween asleep and wake? Sigh. Thou, nature, art my goddess. To thy law, my services are bound. Wherefore should I have a confession to make? I don't know what I'm saying, right? That might be obvious to you, but you see, I struggle with something called self-awareness. That's what you people, whatever teacher is not being paid enough to watch this, has been telling me since I started going to this school. And I wish I didn't have to be self-aware. Jesus. I mean, what is this guy even saying? Nature doesn't have any laws. He's like an animal. I wish I was an animal. They don't have to be self-aware. They can just be. Just eat and not get eaten. Eat. Sleep. Fuck. I mean, that's life, really, not this. Not this, not whatever I'm doing, whatever I've been doing, whatever you're watching, whatever I was born into. That's just, it's all bullshit. Okay, safety is an illusion. Nothing matters. God, I wish I could just sometimes like return to ape and live by the real laws of nature. That is that what this guy's talking about? Just fucking do it. Just do it. You know it. You know. Thou, nature, art my goddess. To thy law, my services are bound. Wherefore should I stand in the plague of custom and permit the curiosities of nations to deprive me, for that I am some 12 or 14 moonshines lag of a brother? Why, bastard? Wherefore, base, when my dimensions are as well compact, my mind as generous, and my shape as true as honest madam's issue, why brand they us with base? With baseness, a bastardy base. Base! Who, in the lusty stealth of nature, take more composition and fierce quality than doth within a dull, stale, tired bed go to the creating a whole truck? Sorry, mommy. I'm almost done.
Listen, you need to make sure they have the 17 silk coral fabrics, 30 pashminas, and 3 12-inch high boots made out of faux calfskin. One of the fabrics is peach parfait. Of course, there's a difference. That can't be right. We ordered them 3 weeks ago. Did you ask them? Okay, here's what I'm going to need you to do. Go to the front of the fabric store, and ask for a job application. This is ridiculous. I don't get what's so hard about properly picking pigmented pieces produced in Prague. I don't feel bad. Okay, it's my fault she's lost, and it's my fault Rihanna won't release another album. Jeez, why do I have to be in charge of all the newborns? These kids grew up collecting Teen Vogue covers. Now they come in here all starry-eyed with no experience, thinking it's going to be fun. But it's not that easy. If you're not prepared to work, someone is. Speaking of, this isn't even my job. My boss is in charge of training the new employees, but he's too busy hooking up with the secretary and worrying about the wrong load. This job already doesn't give you a break long enough to breathe. Now I have to take on his job on top of my job title since no one wants to get any actual work done. I don't have time for this. My massage isn't till 4. Well, look who's late on their first day. Yes, very cute and professional. Is it giving main character? All jokes aside, sweetie, this is a fashion company. Running fashionably late is only acceptable for the red carpet. And you and your pink body mist, it just won't do. Welcome to the next 9.5 months of your life. Stuffington's Gaze, the biggest magazine and key to every young femme's fantasy. You want to be here. The question is how long? With 500,000 crazed girls, gays, and the well-dressed community trembling for a spot to dip their foot in. Don't be nervous. You'll love it here. Let's see. It's still early enough for me to lay down how things work over here. As you know, the big boss, Mr. Cowell, decided to give you the opportunity to be our 10 months temporary intern. No, you'll never get to see him in that glowing skin in person, but trust me, it's smooth. And I'm sure you've prepared well for this. Out of all the top designers, who's your favorite Paul? Paul Denise? Wrong! Your answer is Sean Paul. Inside humor. And I'm sure you've heard the talk of the town that we have a lot of shoe closets, and they try to guess, which is also true, not to brag. Take your pick. 69? Close. 77. We are afforded having such a vast amount of rooms, authentic jewels, purse collections, and other luxury items through partnering with 5-star boutiques. We work well together. So your job is running the basics. But don't underestimate the load. You are the foundation that keeps us all afloat. Where would we be without toasted cream cheese bagels and unnecessarily long Starbucks orders? So fun, right? I was an intern. We've all had to start somewhere. It'll go quicker before you know it. Eventually, you'll get to my position. Mr. Cowell's assistant, number one, the assistant art director, getting to keep things running smooth and sharp around here while he attends to bigger business. You're asking, was I allowed to fire that girl on the phone? What? I'm just practicing. I'm sure she's crying. She'll stop eventually. But I've got myself to think about. When you work so hard from being the coffee run girl to Mr. Cowell's assistant number 5, all you can think about is how far you can really go. I'll be Mr. Cowell. It's the capitalistic dream. There is a promotion that everyone here knows I've earned that's up for grabs. Assistant fashion editor. I've been working at it for almost 4 years. That gray taupe polished desk in that medium venti sized office, 3 floors below his. If you earn that spot, he's taking you to Milan and gifting you with a one-of-a-kind emerald-coated dress. Sources say it belonged to Madonna. I am not sources. I'm moving up the ladder. When I get it, child me is going to be so excited to check it off the list. You know, I couldn't help but notice Sally isn't here today. She could be stuck in traffic, or kissing Mr. Cowell's gluteus maximus, or stuck in traffic. I mean, today's the big day to find out who got that position. I mean, after that stunt she pulled 2 weeks ago, how couldn't I wish her nothing but the best? When this new position got announced, Sally and I hung out and went to the spa. Her treat. Her treat! Now, I can't prove what she told the specialist, but I woke up that day with my face broken out in hives! And I'm surprised I never took vengeance on it. Like, if you did deep analysis, my fascination with Matilda and Parent Trap and the Home Alone franchise and Dennis the Menace 1 and 2 would allege I'm holding a grudge. But I forgave her, though. I understand that we're both great contenders for this spot. So, I invited her to lunch yesterday. My treat. It's out of my hands, though. I put all my faith in the stars. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. May she rest. She's on bed rest. Oh, please. You really think peanuts are gonna kill her? So dramatic. She's the one playing hopscotch with my face. And you're right, absolutely. I could have killed her. And this job isn't worth going to jail. Who's gonna get the promotion? You know what? I should eat. Listen, this job is gonna make you question your life choices, but the benefits will make you sit down. And you need to be ready for it, okay? Or everyone in this office is gonna run you over. But I'll show you how things work around here. If you request something from Mr. Cowell for me. And because you can't get kicked out so suddenly. It's pathetic. Okay. So in order to conquer Office Survival 101, you have to learn how to be nice nasty. Also known as 4 a.m. scenarios in your head that will never happen. Let's play. So let's say Stacy walks up to you so quiet you can't even hear her footsteps. Can't trust that. She says, nice top. Is it Dior? You walk up to her like this and say, and customized. I noticed you're wearing 2 Prada bracelets today. I loved buy one, get one free sales when I was little. The key word is little. So humiliating. She's going to scream. Negative 10 XP. Intermediate level. So Ryan tells you, it seems you've been lagging behind on work since your last promotion. I'd love to help. Oh, yes, he would. For my job! So you say to him, that's so kind of you, Ryan. My engagement ring has just been a little heavy, but I can handle it better without it now. Aimed for his marital status. I mean, so rude. Trying to underestimate me? He has a big head. And an ego, too. Double blow! Negative 20 XP. Expert level. Francesca says, was that your third break? I mean, I could be wrong though. I just noticed. No. Don't wiggle out of this, Francesca. Stop perceiving me. Come get this flame. Now what do we want to tell Francesca? Because I don't know how to play chess, but I can play games. How about, oh, actually it was my second permitted break. And I don't know if my mind is deceiving me. She's deceiving me because I think I might have seen you sneak a bite out of your bacon burrito wrap. Don't worry, it's no big deal. Just be mindful when it comes to plastic wrap and your carbon footprint. Most things you donate to thrift stores after a while still end up going to landfill. Ooh, that was a little too real. Let's have a redo. So let's tell her, I love your skirt. Where'd you get it? Mean Girls Ultimate Bar! Oh, it's raining 1,000 XP coins! Money, 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 money! Right now? Oh, my God. This is Lilith speaking. It It's a scam call from debt collectors. Like, I don't have debt. I don't claim that energy. Manifesting works. Oh. Sally. Wow, you were here? Didn't notice you come in. Oh. Congratulations. Hello, Mr. Cowell? So I heard the good news from Sally and just wanted to stop by and say it was well deserved. She's resilient, and you picked the right candidate. No. I can say it. I'm tired. Aren't you tired? This company is exploiting its workers. Sally and I wouldn't even be competing against each other if you opened up more positions. I don't hate her. We're both hard workers. This industry makes us selfish, and that's disgusting. You know, and I can admit I'm at fault too. I put pressure on myself out of fear of failure. I made it this far in life, and I'm scared it won't matter. What this company needs is to pave a way for aspiring fashion enthusiasts, creating more space for who are up and coming in the industry. We don't deserve crumbs like this position. Sometimes we deserve that seat. And you know I'm right. You agree? Really? So, I got fired. Not shocked at all, but it's what I needed to do. Forget this place. Capitalism is gonna fall apart in the next century anyway. Yeah, you still work here though. Sorry. Oh, hold on. Hi, this is Lilith. Yes? Mm-hmm. He said that? This is insane. Oh my gosh. Thank you. Thank you. Have a good day. There was another spot. I just got promoted to the editor in chief. I'm Mr. Cowell's boss.